about his trips to Washington. You know, we can't have this meeting because I'm going to be in Washington. And why they were in Washington was to basically collude the SEC and other members in Washington so that they would allow Goldman Sachs and also other investment banks to have more leverage, to basically be able to borrow against, you know, crappy securities and assets and book positions in order to make something of them that they weren't, so they could compete with the likes of JP Morgan Chase and Citigroup that had all these, you know, people's deposits and people's loans, and, you know, because of Glass-Steagall repeal were bigger mega banks, and they wanted to basically compete. So what happened was there was this beginning of a real race to do that, and I was looking at, you know, tremendously bad deals. I mean, this was around the time, you know, this seemed before Enron, you know, became known to the world per se as being fraudulent, but the energy companies, the broadband companies, the communication companies, what the banks were just doing with each other in terms of buying and selling, you know, packages of really faulty loans so they could take get a, you know, a capital sort of, you know, a check mark on their books from the Fed and basically not have to hold as much money behind their risk. That was all starting to really heat up around then, and I really saw that was not going to end well. And the first book I wrote, actually the very first piece I wrote was for Fortune, but it spawned other people's money, was that, you know, these banks together are creating a massive problem, and Washington is letting them. The derivatives market at the time for credit and CDOs, which are now, you know, these part of the toxic asset pyramid, were babies at the time. You know, they're literal babies. And I was looking at these positions growing, and you know, the first thing I wrote in the first chapter of Other People's Money was, you got to watch this credit derivatives department. It is not transparent. It is a disaster waiting to happen. So are CDOs and everything else. So I think part of it, and I had no idea that this would grow into such a catastrophe, because the amounts were so much smaller then, and it was let loose for so long. The risk, the toxicity of all of it has grown so much over the years since that it became a much bigger problem globally for everyone. But again, all of that was I'm not going to say beginning when I left. I mean, it was beginning before I left, but it was really coming to its sort of first head point. And you know, given all of that, I just you know, what was being done inside was wrong, and what was going to happen later was going to be a disaster. And I felt the need to, you know, sort of leave, and I couldn't stop talking or writing about it. I still can't, because I think it's really important.
Well, it certainly is. It's threatening our entire civilization, everybody's savings, our currencies, our economies, as everything is fed into this fraud in an attempt to prop it up. And I've interviewed so many economists, but you were inside of it. I want to get your take on this and then ask, where is it all headed? But every economist I talk to explains, we're talking about over $1,000 trillion in derivatives and garbage. Huge national corporate private debts at all-time record, rotting infrastructure, and third world countries being destroyed by the increase in commodities because of currency devaluations. And it's a black hole that we have no hope of paying off because it's a fraud. So, A, where do you see this going? B, okay, the banks use the crises to hold everybody hostage and get more and more power. When everything's wrecked, do they just think some authoritarian system is going to keep them safe from what they've created? Because they're unleashing hell here.
Well, the first thing is, because of their hold and because of what they have created and how they've been subsidized by governments and by central banks, they really do believe they can ride it out. I mean, even just recently, you know, we have another, you know, $400 billion sort of, you know, twist policy, Operation Twist. I call it Operation, you know, Great Depression too. But, you know, of the Fed basically buying $400 billion, you know, of longer term maturities. What are you doing there? You're just sort of like pushing the problem into the future. You're not solving anything. You're not deleveraging these derivatives. You're not saying to banks that they have to really mark their books at where they're at, and if that means they look insolvent, so be it. They need to be destroyed, or they need to fail in a proper way. None of that is happening. Because none of that is happening, and because instead there is continued money and bailout funds and debt being thrown at this problem rather than determining a solution from the bottom up for this problem, it will continue to grow. And so what I see, and I wish I didn't, is that there's no opposition to this. There, you know, even if banks, the larger banks, you know, were to be allowed to fail, which they are not, it would create a knock-on effect, and then there would have to be some strong decisions from people.
So you're damned if you do, you're damned if you don't. Then.
But here's the thing. All of this could still be stopped. And it could have been in 2008. We could have said, you know what, J.P. Morgan Chase, you're not allowed to have Bear Stearns. You know what, Bank of America, who was completely insolvent and with you know, was facing all sorts of settlement cases, all sorts of fraud. You know, you can't have Merrill Lynch. You know, all of this should have done back then. It wasn't. It can still be done now. These banks can be made more transparent and smaller so that we can see what we are dealing with rather than propping it up with money and money and money being printed, with our currency being devalued, with debt being accumulated.
Okay, I understand there's ways to extricate ourselves. The problem is the bankers have put their people in the command positions in the Republican and Democratic parties. The only person that will talk about the elephant in the room is Ron Paul. He gets demonized and attacked. They're clearly not changing course. So where are we going in closing?
So we're going to continue to get worse. I mean, we had a Great Depression that lasted for 7-8 years globally in the 30s. And, you know, that's what I'm writing about in my fiction book in Black Tuesday. But it's going to continue now because it's a deeper problem now. There were more derivatives. There were more fraud. There's more money being printed to subsidize it. I think this is going to last longer.
Tell us about Black Tuesday, the new book. This is, you know, your first fiction book, but it's also based in reality, kind of a history or near future type book. And I know sometimes a fiction based on reality can get more attention than even, I guess, the last couple of best-selling New York Times best-selling books that you've written that are nonfiction.
Yeah, and I thought that way there could be a human face to it. Actually, someone very kindly suggested the book was my way of putting a human face on Goldberg's The Crash of 1929 book, and that wasn't really my intent. It was a nice compliment. But basically the idea is that, you know, it's about a woman, it's about a family, it's about sort of this oppression of, you know, a struggling working class and a struggling middle class at the time, and how bankers literally, you know, take this entitlement and kind of tell themselves that it's okay, it's just one bad signature here, it's one bad fraudulent deal there, and it grows and grows and grows. And the villain in my book is actually Jack Morgan, who, you know, it's not the exact story of how he did it, but I can imagine certain things do actually, probably did happen in a way, is that there were some really fraudulent deals back then that J.P. Morgan Chase, which was then just Morgan Bank, did that really helped cause the 1929 crash and unleash the Great Depression. There were bankers then shorting their own banks while they were using their customers' money to prop up the market to suck in more investors at the last moment before 6 to 8 months later it all fell apart on them in the middle of the Great Depression. So what I'm just showing is the human side of that. I'm following a woman who gets involved, who doesn't want to be a hero, who doesn't set out to be a hero, and is very flawed in very many ways, but who sees it for what it is, and it takes great personal struggle to really bring it to people's attention, and there's a lot of problems, and there's, you know, there's a love triangle and everything else that happens in fiction, but the idea is that one unlikely person might not make a tremendous difference, but when called to the occasion can step up, and that's really, you know, sort of the background, and it takes place in 1929, which is very, very similar to what's going on right now.
Now the book is coming out any second now, right?
Yeah, it's out on Amazon right now, and it's in the iBook store right now, so it is out electronically now. You can get it, like, right now. And then, you know, in terms of stores, you know, hopefully in the next couple of weeks.
Yeah, so the future is now. Yes. So now with digital, it's out in the stores the next few weeks, and the book is Black Tuesday. Naomi Prinz, thank you so much for spending time with us, and I look forward to having you back on as we chart what's happening, and hopefully with people like you out there exposing these dastardly creatures, we're going to be able to bring them to justice and reverse the course of this corrupt system before we're all brought to rack and ruin.
Thank you so much, Alex.
Thank you. Well, ladies and gentlemen, that concludes InfoWars Nightly News. I'm going to go out there and shoot a video that we're going to post on InfoWars.com and PrisonPlanet.com tonight that is a call to action to protest the Federal Reserve itself. The actual real criminal banksters, not capitalism's bad and all of Wall Street and 30,000 companies are evil. Now, I had the Dallas Morning News and other publications contact us today, and they're saying, so you're doing a nationwide thing at Dallas, Houston, and San Antonio. No. I am simply putting out the idea that, hey, instead of just going in to your financial district and griping at Wall Street, which has a lot of good companies on it that hire Americans and others, why not go to the big six mega banks masquerading as the Federal Reserve? They're the ones that actually set all this up that Naomi Prinz just covered. How about we actually go after the real problem? It's the Federal Reserve running George Soros and Buffett and others to get more bailout money. They want the austerity. They want to raise taxes, cut your benefits so more money can be paid to them. They're the ones using the European Union to fully destroy all sovereignty in Europe right now, holding them hostage. We just talked to a Goldman Sachs insider agreeing with my analysis. This is happening. So please get the word out to your Facebook, your Twitter, your MySpace, everywhere. Call your friends and family. Tell them that we are going to start out occupying the Dallas Federal Reserve and the sidewalk around it this Friday. I will arrive after the radio show at 6 p.m. and I'll speak for about 2 hours. Then I will get in my RV. I will drive to the Federal Reserve. The big branch for Region 11 is in Dallas, but it's sub-reserve. It's an even bigger building. Is in Houston and San Antonio. I'll be in Houston high noon on Saturday, and then I'll be 10 a.m. to noon or so with people there at the San Antonio Federal Reserve. Now, no matter where you are, you're a majority of one. Get your friends, your family, your neighbors, go down, demonstrate, call the media, let them know you're going. Go down and demonstrate at your Federal Reserve, especially if you're around one of the big 12 ones or one of their substations. And let them know that you're aware of what they're doing. Now, with the Dallas situation, I've got to do the nightly news. I've got to, you know, as a general here who goes out on the front lines, but I've also got to be here in our command center and try to research all this, get it together. I've got to do the radio show. I've got to do the nightly news. And so what I'm going to do is if people do occupy the Dallas Fed and if they stay there, and you can stay one day and then others will arrive. We'll be talking about it on air. They arrive on Sunday with your sleeping bags or whatever. If we keep that thing occupied for a week or so, it will become a big national story. And Sunday, I'm going to go to Dallas Friday. I'm going to turn around and go down to Houston. Then Saturday, then Sunday, I'll be in San Antonio. Then I'm going to go back to Austin, regroup, do the two-hour radio show, 4 to 6 p.m. Central. And then if the occupation works, and who knows, it might spring up in San Francisco. It might pop up at the Fed out in Lincoln, Nebraska. It might pop up at the one at Kansas City. It might be the one at St. Louis. It might be the one in Richmond. Wherever it happens, I will either get on a plane or get on our new InfoWars RV, and I will drive to that location and broadcast from there. Okay? So I don't expect the place where I go is where this is going to happen. But wherever you're at, be part of history, face down the real tyrants. Don't let the globalists come in with their counter-revolution, their false counter-revolution of communists. And people calling to raise taxes on the middle class and transfer the money to bankers. Don't let them speak for you. The American people aren't just going to occupy Wall Street and attack capitalism. We're going to go after the crony capitalists who are the opposite of capitalists, the opposite of free market, the monopoly men. So the big one to be at, we're going to Houston and San Antonio because we know there's groups down there. We want to point out this is at every Federal Reserve location. But the big one, the one we're going after, and I had this in my gut when I said yesterday on air, I said, should we occupy the Dallas, the San Antonio, or the Houston? And last time I checked, 80%+ in the poll. In fact, guys, I know we're at the end of the show, but pull up InfoWars.com, go to the bottom right-hand corner, and there's the poll. Show people the poll over here on the camera, and then click it. It was like 80% this morning when I looked of 3,000 votes or something total. Want us to occupy the Dallas Fed. So, all over the country, I'll go there to kick it off. Then I will race around stirring up other people like Paul Revere, literally in the bus. Yeah, there it is, close to 3,000 votes, and it's 78%. It was like 80 this morning. So, close to 3,000 votes, 78% with the Dallas Federal Reserve, Houston branch of Dallas